بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. Honorable and respected listeners and lovers of Sahaba رضي الله عنهم and lovers of the Sira of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, how fortunate are we that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم's Sira is so all-inclusive, where every aspect of his life is so well encompassed and encapsulated and covered by the scholars of hadith and seerah. This is through the efforts of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Sahaba radiallahu anhum documented every detail in regards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Mubarak life. Anyway, I wanted to discuss Abdullah bin Zaid bin Abdi Rabbihi radiallahu anhu. But up till that point, just to recap one more point in regards to Hijrah, because we just discussed certain aspects and those individuals who came into contact with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the Mubarak journey of Hijrah. I wanted to just mention how all-inclusive is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, documented in the books of Hadith and Seerah, where even every venue that he passed through on his journey of Hijrah, despite how unknown those areas are by many others, but the scholars of Seerah document these regions in the books of Seerah because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam set foot in these regions. How fortunate are these vicinities because of the footsteps of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I just wanted to mention but a few, because I previously mentioned under the discussion of Ummu Ma'bad radiallahu anha, and some time before when I discussed her life, her Mubarak life radiallahu anha, I mentioned that when they refer to Tariqul Hijrah as the highway in Arabia in today's times, they're referring to that region, and I was corrected by Mufti Ayub Sahab from Medina Munawwara that actually that route is not the journey of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's Hijrah, meaning the highway today from Makkah Mukarrama to Medina Munawwara. Actually, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's journey was via another route. And shukr to Allah ta'ala, he takes different guests to Medina Munawwara along that route, allowing people to visit these beautiful regions. Allah ta'ala give us all tawfiq to go to these areas that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed through. Allah ta'ala give us the noor of the beautiful life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of these areas documented is Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went, you know, via Usfan, then he passed Amaj, then he crossed and got to Qadid, and then he went via Kharrar, and then he went through Thaniyatul Murra, and then he went through an area called Liqf, and others pronounce it as Laqf. Then he went via Madlajatul Laqfin, then sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went via the valley of Mahaj, Madlajatul Mahaj. Then he crossed a vicinity called Marjah Mahaj. Then he went through a vicinity called Dhil Ghudwain. Then Dhi Kasar. Then crossed a valley called Jadajid. Then an area called Ajrad. Then Dhatu Silmin. Then another vicinity called Mudlijatu Ti'hin. Then an area called Ababid. Then he went via an area called Fajja. Then he reached an area called Aruj. Then he passed a vicinity called Thaniyatul Ghair, next to Rakuba. And then he, and you know, when we discussed the incident where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met the highway robbers, that was there, Thaniyatul Ghair. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went via the valley called Ri'm. Then he reached Quba. Then recently we discussed where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed for a few days, and then finally in the home of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Definitely this is the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that made the Sahaba radiallahu anhum document every aspect of his life. How fortunate are we as the Ummah of Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that every aspect of Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Mubarak life is available to us. Such detail. Anbiya alayhimus salatu wa sallam, all the Anbiya alayhimus salam were so beloved to Allah, were so great. But which aspect of their lives reach us today? How fortunate are we as the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my respected lovers of Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's entire life with such exclusivity reaches us. All this is due to the barakat of Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Allah give us tawfiq to value the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Interestingly, Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived in Medina Munawwara. What a welcoming. Everyone wanted to welcome Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and be his host. Everyone cried for this opportunity. Allah blessed Abu Ayyub radiallahu anhu. And then, but the first spot in which the camel halted and knelt down was an empty spot owned by two orphan children, Sahal and Suhail radiallahu anhumah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then offered to purchase that land. They insisted that they want to give it and donate it towards the cause of deen. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refused. So we learn from the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when to take and when not to take. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu then purchased the plot of Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There were graves of mushrikeen there. It was excavated, exhumed, and further on, Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was built. And Sahaba radiallahu anhu participated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the construction of Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What a scene, subhanallah. All the Sahaba radiallahu anhum making dhikrullah and involved in the construction of Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what inspired them? It was Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself carrying the bricks and bringing it for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and involving himself in the khidmah of the masjid with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. There's an amazing incident narrated by Usayd ibn Khudayrin radiallahu anhu, that as the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were busy in the construction of Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was involved. Usayd radiallahu anhu approaches the Nabi of Allah, taking the bricks from him. A'tinihi, O Nabi of Allah, hand them over to me, I will do it for you. You rest and see what's being done. Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اذهب رحتمل غيره. Usayd, go take another brick. فَإِنَّكَ لَسْتَ بِأَفْقَرَ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنِّي. You are not more in need of Allah's mercy than I. Allahu Akbar. This is Habibullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's akhlaq and humility. This is his khidmah for humanity. And this is his love for the masjid. And this is how he practically taught the ummah. Allah give us tawfiq. That we should humble ourselves and involve ourselves in this physical work for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure. It doesn't have to be that we just get things done by others. But we should also involve ourselves when it comes to the service of deen in this beautiful, beautiful manner like this. And really this humbles an individual. This humbles a human being. It's not the best occasion to recognize oneself when one is in one's office, or one is attending meetings of prominent people. Actually, on occasions like this, we should make shukr to Allah Ta'ala, because where we serving Allah's deen. As Hazrat Maulana Muhammad Ilyas Rahmatullah Ali, when the guests of Allah Ta'ala would come to the markaz, and at night he would go, and when everyone was asleep after midnight, he would clean the toilets, because there wasn't people to do it. And he himself would do this khidmah. And then he would make ghusl and wash himself. And in tahajjud he would cry and make shukr that, oh Allah, you have given me the opportunity to serve your guests. So when we serve Allah Ta'ala's deen, we should actually make shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sahaba radiallahu anhum together were making this dhikr and encouraging each other with this slogan, La aisha illa aishul akhirah, Allahumma arhamil ansara wal muhajira. La aisha illa aishul akhirah, Allahumma arhamil ansara wal muhajira. Definitely, there's no life but the life of akhirah. Akhirah is the real life. This was the slogan of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. The real life is the life of akhirah. Allah, shower your mercies on the ummah, the muhajireen and the ansar, radiallahu anhum. And then also, this was also another rendition. And this was, in one voice, Sahaba radiallahu anhum were rendering. But this other slogan comes in the reports of Sirah. لَإِنْ قَعْدْنَا وَالنَّبِيُّ يَعْمَلْ لَذَاكَ مِنَّا الْعَمَلُ الْمُضَلَّلُ. لَإِنْ قَعْدْنَا وَالنَّبِيُّ يَعْمَلْ لَذَاكَ مِنَّا الْعَمَلُ الْمُضَلَّلُ. How can we sit when the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself is serving Allah and serving and working? Definitely that would be something far astray and away from the truth. If we allow the Nabi of Allah, the greatest of Allah's creation, to work and toil and serve, and we must sit, never, that can never be possible. Another Sahabi renders, هذا الحمال لا حمال خيبرا هذا أبر لربنا وأطهرا. This is a real load. This is the load, not the loads of treasures in Khaybar. This is more righteous and more pure, and this is for Allah's pleasure. Meaning, you know, in lands of prominence where one carries gold and silver and fruit and enjoyments, Sahaba are saying to carry for Allah's pleasure, to carry the bricks of the masjid, this is the real load that will give us salvation in the Akhirah. And whilst Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was guiding the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, another Sahabi says, لا يستوي من يعمر المساجد يدأب فيها قائما وقاعدا ومن يرى عن الغبار حائدا. That one who is serving and working and building the masajid, standing and sitting, he can never be in ranks in Akhirah. The one who keeps himself away from the dust and medial work can never be like the one who serves. And as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was overseeing the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, there was one Sahabi, Talq bin Ali Yamami al-Hanafi radiallahu anhu, and he was very good in building and laying bricks, and he was very good in mixing the tar. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam puts him in that task. And this is a report by Ibn al-Asir rahimahullah. He narrates from Razin. The Sahabi is Razin. Razin radiallahu anhu says that this one Sahabi was so good in mixing the tar, and he came from Hadramaut. What was his name? Talq bin Ali Yamami Hanafi radiallahu anhu. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put him in that task. And then he asked to be occupied in something else. Allah's Nabi says, no, ilzam anta hadha shughl fa inni araka tuhsinuhu. You are a professional in this avenue, so you stick to this and others will do other chores. And then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave du'as, رحم الله امرأ أحسن صنعته. Allah, you have mercy on that individual who does his work with professionality, with perfection, with importance. When someone does something perfectly to the best of his ability and he gives his all in that, appreciating this favor of Allah, allowing him, who allows him to do this, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave du'as. We learn from here, as believers, we shouldn't do things haphazardly. We shouldn't do things, you know, just quickly. But we should do things with importance, with ihtimam, with professionality, with beauty. We should do our duties with beauty. And this is the teachings of the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the masjid was constructed. One very important fikr was now to gather the ummah for salah. And now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made mashura with Sahaba radiallahu anhum. What should be done? What is the next step? How do we gather the ummah? And in that, different opinions were presented. In this fikr and concern, different opinions came. One was that of, you know, kindling a fire. The other was that of a bell. The other was of that of blowing a horn. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loathed the use of fire because this bore resemblance to the Majus, the Zoroastrians. And he didn't like the idea of bells because this resembled the Christians, and that of the trumpet also, because this was tantamount to emulating the Jews. Now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam listened to these opinions, but he disliked them. So we learn from there that as people of Iman, we should not imitate the non-believers. We should imitate and emulate Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anyway, during this period of Mashura and Fikr, there was a great Sahabi, Abdullah bin Zaid bin Abdi Rabbihi. I repeat, Abdullah bin Zaid bin Abdi Rabbihi radiallahu an, from the Banu Jusham tribe. He was Khazraji and he was Ansari. His kunya, his appellation was Abu Muhammad radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Amongst the other Sahaba, he also sat with this concern, how are we going to resolve this situation? How would we come to a solution? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants to invite the ummah towards the masjid. What would we do? How are we going to gather everyone? Up to this point, for a few months, everyone was just coming at the time where they understood it's the time of salah. But now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants something constructive. And this Sahabi was in concern and in fikr. And at night Allah shows him this Mubarak dream. The assembly of Sahaba radiallahu anhum dispersed without reaching any concrete resolution. But this concern and unease of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a profound effect on the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, especially Abdullah bin Zaid bin Abdi Rabbihi radiallahu anhu. Now during these discussions, this great Sahabi sees a dream. He sees a man dressed in green apparel, clutching onto a bell in his hand, walking past. So Abdullah radiallahu anhu said, I asked him, will you sell me this bell? He said, what do you want to do with it? I said, I want to summon the people for salah by ringing the bell. The man with this green cloak remarked, should I not enlighten you on something far more superior than the bell? So I said to him, why not? So he said, surely I would teach you. And the man then said these words. And these are the words of Adhan, where in the dream of Abdullah bin Zayd radiallahu anhu, this angel of Allah teaches him the Adhan. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And he teaches him the entire Adhan. Subhanallah. Four times Allahu Akbar. Then, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya 'alas salah. Hayya 'alas salah. Hayya 'alal falah. Hayya 'alal falah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. And now, as the Sahabi radiallahu anhu hears the Adhan, and it was with quite detail, the angel of Allah teaches it to him. Then the angel of Allah teaches him Iqamah. That now when you establish the Salah, and everyone stands up towards the Salah, after Hayya 'alal Falah, add on the words, قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ. So Abdullah radiallahu anhu then further relates that the next morning I presented myself before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and I related this dream to him. On hearing this dream, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pronounced, إِنَّ هَذِهِ الرُّؤْيَا حَقٌّ إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Certainly this dream is true. And then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, InshaAllah. Here we learn that inshallah is not something of doubt. Here inshallah is to bring barakat and blessings in the statement. So we learn as believers that we should not underestimate inshallah. When with inshallah we gain the help of Allah. With inshallah we gain nearness to Allah. With inshallah we gain proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And examples of this are found in the Quran Kareem. So we should never fail to recite inshallah, because this is an injunction of Quran, and we should never take inshallah lightly as well. Anyway, the next day when he presents this to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very happy. And then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Abdullah bin Zayd radiallahu anhu to teach these words to Bilal radiallahu ta'ala. And when Abdullah bin Zayd radiallahu anhu taught these words to Bilal radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu then hears these words and he rushes forward and he submitted saying, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالَّذِي بَعْثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ مِثْلَ الَّذِي أُرِيَ. I also saw a similar dream like that of what Abdullah bin Zayd radiallahu anhu had seen. It seems as though this injunction of Sharia was confirmed through a dream. But actually in Islam, we do not draw proof through dreams. But here the Sahabi sees a dream and it's confirmed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's approval. And not only was it a dream, but it was actually an incident that happened before. On the night of Mi'raj, Aisha radiallahu anha reports that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam called out the Adhan in the skies and he urged me forward to lead the Salah. So I led the prayers, I led the Malaika in Salah in the skies. So there's reports and quite a few reports where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hears the Adhan and he led the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa sallam in Salah. And then he hears the Adhan and then he's put forth by Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam, and he leads the malaika of Allah ta'ala in salah. And then when Abdullah bin Zaid radiallahu anhu sees this incident in his dream, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam confirms it, that certainly this is true, because yes, it was conforming to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had already seen in the skies on the night of Mi'raj. And certainly the sequence of the words of Adhan is so remarkable. There's so many messages and teachings of Deen in the beautiful rendition of the Adhan. There's the message of Tawheed. The message of Tawheed and the greatness of Allah. The message of Risala. The message of Ibadah. The message of the hereafter in so much of detail. That's why anyone who ponders over the beautiful wordings of the Adhan would be filled with Iman. And such a reminder it is towards Deen and towards Akhirah. Such a da'wat it is, such an invitation it is. Allahu Akbar repeated 4 times. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu, Allah give us tawfiq. Hazrat Mufti Dhul-Haq Sahib Damat Barakatuhum explained so beautifully that here, this repetition of Adhan in this manner is denoting the fikr of the Mu'adhin and the Mu'min, which is to take Deen to the four corners of the world. That the message of Allah's greatness, the message of Allah's glory and grandeur and might and power should be taken to the four corners of the world. And then Tawheed and Risalat, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, this message that humanity should hear, that Allah is one, I bear testimony that Allah is one, I bear witness that Allah has no partner, I bear witness in the finality of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final messenger of Allah. So after Tawheed and Risalat and the message of the greatness of Allah, then humanity is called to ibadat, and the greatest ibadat being salah. Hayya ala salah, hayya ala salah, repetition to show importance. And then hayya ala falah, through salah coming into our life, through us hastening to the masjid, through masjid Allah will give us the whole of Deen. And like that, we would gain success in our lives. Falah. And falah is that success that encompasses salvation and happiness and success in this world and the next. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And then humanity is called again that Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. The 5th and the 6th time encompasses even the highest mountain, that there also the da'wat of Deen should be given. And the lowest ravine and valley should not be missed, but the message of Deen should be taken there also. Then humanity is informed, La ilaha illallah. That O humanity, O insan, O jinnat, whether you accept or not, whether you like it or not, whether you come or not, Allah is still the greatest. Allah is one. Allah has no partner. We all need Allah, and He is totally independent. So really, how beautiful is the meaning of Adhan? That's why there's so many reports, as we learn when we sit in the halqas of ta'aleem. Allah give us tawfiq. Sit in the halqa of ta'aleem in the masjid. Sit in the halqa of ta'aleem. Establish the halqa of ta'aleem in our homes. We learn how Sahaba radiallahu anhum would become pale and awed when hearing the Adhan. When we're hearing the Adhan also, we should think that if my boss is calling me, if my father is calling me, what right do I have to delay in responding to that call? Imagine when the call is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How diligently should we respond to that call? Passionately, lovingly, diligently. Allah give us tawfiq. And also, I implore one and all, don't lose out on the opportunity of giving the Adhan. Like Sahaba radiallahu anhum would vie with one another to give the Adhan. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if the Ummah knew the value of Adhan, people would vie with one another and race with one another to give the Adhan, to such an extent that what would solve the problem would finally be that they cast lots, because everyone is early and trying to give the Adhan. Sahaba tried so hard, they wanted to give the Adhan. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the time will come before Qiyamah where people would underestimate Adhan. People would not give importance to Adhan. People would neglect the Adhan. Allah Ta'ala save us. That's why wherever we travel in the world, wherever we go in the world, give the Adhan. Call out the Adhan in a beautiful, melodious tone. Learn from the ulama how to pronounce the words of Allah Ta'ala and the words of the Adhan correctly. How much of reward we would gain in Allah Ta'ala's in Allah Ta'ala's closeness and in Allah Ta'ala's rewards that Allah Ta'ala will give us. That's why in the Ahadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "La yasma'u sawt al-mu'adhdhini insun wala jinnun wala shay illa shahida lahu yawm al-qiyamah." Not a ins or a jinn or any creation of Allah, like a rock or a tree or a blade of grass, that hears the mu'adhdhin, except that it would bear testimony on the day of judgment that Allah, this mu'min invited to you. This mu'min invited to you. So imagine wherever we go in the world, what a da'wah it is. And also I implore you, my respected listener and lovers of Sahaba radiallahu anhum and lover of Sahaba radiallahu anhum, explain the meaning of the adhan to the non-Muslims as well. They don't know what it means. Many a time they feel we're mesmerizing them. Clarify it to them. Explain to them that we do not mesmerize. We do not do such things as Muslims. We are a pure community. What we are saying is share the greatness of Allah and the mercy of Allah, and we are praying for you. Explain to them this, and then invite them to the masjid. When you explain this to them, that every time they hear the adhan, it will become a da'wat for them, my respected listeners. And again, when we are in our travels, don't lose out on the opportunity of adhan. Stop at a garage, call out the adhan, then the iqamah, and then perform our salah openly. Don't feel shy to practice our deen. In the ahadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "He who renders the iqamah and then the salah, his two angels would perform salah with him. Salla ma'ahu malaka." But if he renders the adhan and then the iqamah and then the salah, صَلَّى مَعَهُ مِنْ جُنُودِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يُرَى طَرَفَاهُ. Allah will send so many of His creation to join Him in salah. The malaika of Allah and the beautiful creation of Allah would perform salah with Him, that the first soft would be so filled that if he had the ability to see the malaika of Allah, he would not be able to see the ends of the softs, of the first saf, because of so many malaika of Allah coming to join him in that salah, because they respond to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah give us tawfiq to respond to the beautiful call of the adhan. And also when the muadhin renders the adhan, remain silent, remain in dhikr, remain in fikr, and repeat the words of the muadhin. And after that, perform, recite the dua after the adhan, and salutations upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then your duas are guaranteed. Allah give us tawfiq to take these opportunities. Something else interesting is, according to Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, the adhan rendered is the adhan of Abdullah bin Zaid radiallahu anhu. And according to Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, the adhan he prefers is the adhan of Abu Mahzura radiallahu anhu, another great Sahabi radiallahu anhu that we have discussed and we would remind the Ummah of when we get the opportunity. Was after the Fath Makkah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invited this youngster to Islam, and he was mimicking the adhan in a derogatory manner. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with akhlaq and tolerance showed him the truth and then taught him the adhan and invited him to Islam and made him his muadhin in Makkah Mukarramah. So Abu Mahdura radiallahu anhu became Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's muadhin, appointed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but over the region of Makkah Mukarramah. So in his adhan there is something called tarji', where certain words in the adhan are repeated softly and then in a loud manner. So the words of adhan are more, but what is heard is exactly the same in the adhan and lesser in the iqamah. But anyway, these are the two adhans of Abdullah bin Zayd radiallahu anhu and Abu Mahzura radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Allah ta'ala save us and our offspring and our children. And that's why we learn that as a child is born, the first thing that a child should hear and what should permeate that child's ears and penetrate that heart is the name of Allah ta'ala through the wordings of the adhan. Adhan in the one ear, iqamah in the other ear. Why? Because adhan is one of the most important sha'air symbols of Islam and symbols of Deen. And my humble request to all, one and all, let us never ever disrespect the Adhan. Never ever disrespect the Adhan. Adhan is a great means of Hidayah, and respecting the Adhan will take us to different levels in the proximity of Allah, in proximity towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ الْأُمِّيِّ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ